Welcome to Across the Goal Line, a sports podcast brought to you by Die Hard fans. Luke got us started over here, Corey Mains right here, and today we got you some Heisman Trophy results from Saturday evening. We also have your NFL review, as we typically do. Also, we got some college football review, and that's where we're going to start, actually. There's only one FBS game played on Saturday, and that was an Army-Navy game, always iconic game. And Army came out on top, surprisingly.
Yeah, for the first time since 2001, right after 9/11. A lot of those players that played in that game actually went on to fight in the war against terrorism, which is still going on today. Army picking up a good win. They got the sing second, as the military academies always want to do. Army picking up a big win. And the players that play in that game too, which I think the reason why I watch the Army-Navy game every year, the one thing I like about it is because the players that are playing in this game are willing to die for the people who are watching the game on national television, on CBS. So, and then I just want to say thanks to, all our military. I didn't say this last week before the game. I just want to say thanks to all our military, whether in the Army, Navy, Marines, or the Coast Guard, or even the Air Force. So I know you have family members that have been in the military. I have as well. So, I'll leave it at that for what I want to say.
I'll say that. I'm not super shocked. I mean, yes, history, Army beating Navy for the first time since 01, yeah. But, of course, Navy coming off a bad loss, a very, heartbreaking loss of sorts to Temple in the AAC championship game. So they might have not been playing to their fullest. I know they lost a couple guys in that game against Temple.
Yeah, and then their quarterback this past week for the Army game was their fourth quarterback for the entire season. Week one, their starter went down after having Keenan Reynolds for the past four seasons, and then their other one got hurt mid-season, and then now the one got hurt in that Temple game. So the quarterback who was playing for Navy, he was in the stands watching the game last year. This year, let alone he's playing in it. He probably would have never thought that, if you ask me, but yeah, Army beat Navy for the first time since 2001, which is pretty impressive, as you said, since Navy had won 14 straight there. So we both picked Navy, 0-1 for both of us last week. I'm 114-80 on the year. You're 134, and what would that be, 60 then? So we'll move into the bowl games here in a second, but the FCS, I went 3-1. He went 2-2 last week. So I'm 44-24 in the year in the FCS. He's 49-19 on the year for the FCS. Semifinal games, the winners of these two games go to the FCS National Championship on January 7th. So James Madison, huge win last week against Sam Houston State at home. They go to North Dakota State, trying to upset the Bison, as the Bison have won six straight FCS National Championships. So you're going to take this game, Corey?
I got to go with North Dakota State. I mean, six straight, got to keep it going, I guess. I mean, also being at home, technically, so.
Yeah.
Always helps.
Yeah, they haven't lost in the Fargo Dome all year. Yeah. So home field advantage will be a factor in this game, but I'm going to take the Dukes. I'm going to take James Madison in an upset. I said when we first started picking the FCS playoff games, James Madison would be a dark horse to possibly win the FCS National Championship this year. I did pick against them one time because I thought New Hampshire would have put up more of a fight, because they put up 50 the week before, and then James Madison goes and puts 50 up on them when they played. And then James Madison put up 60 last week against Sam Houston State. So I got to take James Madison in an upset against North Dakota State from Fargo, North Dakota, this Friday night. And then the second game is Youngstown State goes to Eastern Washington. And then the winner of this game, as I said, will be playing the winner of the other game in the FCS National Championship. So Youngstown State or Eastern Washington, Gordon?
I'm going to go with the home team yet again, Eastern Washington, in this one.
And I'm going to take the road team then, because I like Youngstown State in this matchup. Bo Pelini, former Nebraska coach, he's done one hell of a job with his hometown team. Youngstown State, and what a lot of people would probably say, another upset in the FCS playoffs, but we'll have to see about that. And then the bowl games, I don't know if you have anything else to say.
No,
okay. The bowl games then, or do you want to go with the Heisman and then some of the awards before we get into the bowl games?
Let's just go right into the
go to bowl games. All right. Bowl games, they start this Saturday, December 17th. The first one is the Air Force Reserve Celebration Bowl. It's between two FCS teams, though. It's their, it's the only, it's the second year for this bowl game, and it's the only bowl game between FCS teams. Somewhat neat, I think, if you ask me, because, you know, these FCS teams, they go to play in the playoffs, you know. So you got two teams that go to play in a bowl game. Now, I don't know how these two teams get in this bowl game. Obviously, you got to have a winning record, but we'll look more into that. So North Carolina Central plays Grambling State.
I'm going to go Grambling State.
I'm going to go Grambling State as well. They only have one loss on the year, so I don't think they'll get their second. The Gilda New Mexico Bowl, always a fun game to watch. It's always high scoring. New Mexico, staying at home. They host the University of Texas San Antonio.
I gotta go to New Mexico. I mean, it's their bowl, so
I'm gonna take New Mexico as well. Bob Davey, ever since he left ESPN to get back into coaching, he's turned the Lobos around. So New Mexico as well. The Las Vegas Bowl, I think, could be one of the bowl games of the year, best bowl games of the year. Houston, yeah, they lost Tom Herman. They did hire Major Alpoy from their offense coordinator position to permanent head coach now. They play Donnell Pumphrey in San Diego State, who finished 10th in the Heisman voting because he doesn't get any love because he plays for San Diego State, a team out west.
I got to go with Houston. I think they're definitely more battle-tested than San Diego State Aztecs. And despite not having Tom Herman there anymore, I think it's not really going to make much of a difference in this game.
All right.
Because they still... I mean, they're still going to hold the same values that Herman had
before he left. I can agree with that, but at the same time, we've seen in the past teams who, on the flip side of that, teams who have lost their head coach, they go out in the bowl game and they don't even show up, you know? So I think Donnell Pumphrey is one hell of a player, though, too. I think he's going to run all over Houston's defense. So that's why I'm going to take San Diego State over Houston. Raycon Media, Camellia Bowl, Appalachian State plays Toledo. Both teams are 9-3. App State played in this bowl game last year as well and won on a game-winning field goal. So I gotta take the Mountaineers again.
I'll go with App State in this one. Two straight in the same bowl. That'd be kind of nice, I guess.
Yeah. Last year, first bowl win ever as well. So maybe, you know, go two in a row. Obviously the same bowl game as you said, but you know, it'd still be pretty nice. The Auto Nation Cure Bowl, Central Florida plays Arkansas State. I got to go Central Florida here. One of our good friends, Christian Lezer, is on the team. He should be making an impact next year after having to sit out for a redshirt this year.
Yeah, but I'm going to have to take Arkansas State in that one, though.
All right. Arkansas State, they've been good ever since they joined the FBS level after being in the FCS level there for a time. And then the final game on Saturday, December 17th, the R&L Carriers New Orleans Bowl from the Superdome in New Orleans, Louisiana. You got Southern Miss going up against Louisiana Lafayette, who seems like they're always playing in this bowl game year in and year out.
Oh, give me Louisiana Lafayette. I mean, they're basically right in their backyard, so they basically have home field advantage.
They do, but Southern Miss isn't that far away, so should be a good turnout for the crowd for both respective teams. So Southern Miss, I think, will beat Louisiana Lafayette. Monday, the Miami Beach Bowl. There will be no bowl games this upcoming Sunday. The NFL owns Sundays, as I've said previously. This game will be at approximately 2:30 on Monday afternoon on ESPN. The game last year was unbelievable. Western Kentucky pulled out the victory. They're playing in the Boca Raton Bowl, which is next Tuesday against Memphis, but the Miami Beach Bowl, Central Michigan plays Tulsa.
Give me Tulsa.
I'm also going to take Tulsa. And as I said about that Boca Raton Bowl down in Boca Raton, Florida, Memphis plays Western Kentucky. Western Kentucky actually just lost their head coach. Jeff Brom went to Purdue. Hopefully he turns the Boilermakers around. But Memphis, they got a probably one of the biggest upsets of the year over Houston in Tom Herman's last game a couple weeks ago on Black Friday. So I think Memphis gets it done and they beat Western Kentucky.
I'm going to have to go Western Kentucky, though.
All right, Western Kentucky would get their 11th victory if they get the victory. And then the San Diego County Credit Union Poinsettia Bowl, another fun game to watch. Another fun bowl game to watch, as I should say. BYU plays Wyoming.
I mean, we haven't had BYU on for a while now. We had them a lot in the early seasons.
Yeah, probably I think every week for the first half of the year.
Pretty much, because they're playing against... They're playing a lot of Pac-12 schools.
Then, well, they're an independent school, so they can play whoever the hell they want.
But I picked Wyoming more often than not, so why not? I'm going to stay on the Wyoming bandwagon of sorts.
And that's why I'm going to take BYU, because I picked BYU a lot this year, so I got to stick with BYU.
I did too. But...
So those nine bowl games are from this Saturday until next Wednesday night. We'll be bringing you another live episode of Across the Goal Line next week. And then we'll have the next week's bowl games within the week. We don't want to do all the bowl games at once because, you know, who knows if we want to change our mind. So that's it with the bowl games. Move on to who won the Heisman, Corey?
Who did win the Heisman? Well, as many expected, the man who was projected to win the Heisman did win the Heisman. Lamar Jackson out of Louisville, becoming the first Louisville player to win the Heisman Trophy also. Yep. So that's good for him. But it was a really close race in the end between him and Watson. Those are the only two, really.
It was pretty much a two-man race.
It was a two-man race because, well, Watson came in second, of course. Then Mayfield came in third, but he was miles behind even Watson in voting. So it was Watson and Jackson. It's just Jackson's early work, I guess, was too much.
As I said last week, that's why I picked him, because I thought he did too much, you know, too soon.
Yeah. And, I mean, the way he plays the game is an exciting way to play the game. That's going to really appeal to a lot of voters, too. So,
now, he's only a true sophomore, so he has at least one more year in college.
Yeah.
And then he can decide if he wants to go to the NFL, which I assume he will.
Yeah.
Now, if he turns out in the NFL, he turns out. Who knows if he will, though? You look at past Heisman winners.
Yeah.
You normally don't turn out, especially if you're a quarterback. Look at Tim Tebow and Johnny Manziel, who actually made an appearance at the Heisman ceremony this past weekend.
I mean, but also, of course, you had recent guys like Cam Newton and Jameis Winston who are doing pretty well in the NFL.
And Marcus Mariota.
And Mariota. I mean, he's not in the same level as maybe both of those guys yet. I mean, he's doing well.
Yeah.
I mean, he's not doing phenomenal this year, but he has a good run game in Tennessee now. So he doesn't really need to do much at the moment. So
agreed.
But, yeah, I mean, it could be a problem. I mean, 30-20, only two other guys, Cam Newton and Tim Tebow. One of those guys is good. One of those guys, not so much. My problem with Jackson, of course, I think I've said it before, his size is probably a little less to be desired because Cam Newton's a bigger guy, of course.
He can
take a lot of hits with running the ball. He's able to stand in the pocket, take the hits and stuff like that. Yeah. So a guy like Jackson, it's going to be hard for him, I think, to make a splash in the NFL. We've seen it. Smaller quarterbacks, I mean, not height-wise, but also just like their strength. He's a really smaller guy, so he's not going to be able to run the ball. Like, a guy like RG3 is probably a good example. He'll probably be, if he does make the NFL, he might be good like the first time.
Hopefully Lamar Jackson does not play for the Cleveland Browns though.
Well,
hopefully he doesn't. That would be awful.
But yeah, he's a guy.
Because I would like to see him, see what he's capable of in the National Football League.
He's a guy I think could have a good rookie season, then drop off a little bit once teams get used to him.
Just like RG3.
Just like RG3. So.
As you've said before.
And also, I don't think he's really proven himself to be that great of a thrower. He'll have to work on that a lot in the NFL game. You need to be able to throw the ball.
He did get a little bit better as the season progressed this year, but as the more I look into it, I have started to agree with you more about it. You know, he's more of a runner than he is a passer, and in the NFL, you got to be able to do both.
I mean, throw obviously more.
Exactly.
You should be throwing first, running second.
Yes.
And that's the good balance you need.
Yes.
If you can do that as a quarterback, then yes, you're going to be just fine. But he's a guy that an NFL team's going to have to adapt to him, I think, more so than him adapting to their system, I think, if he goes to a certain team that doesn't have a system in place that he'll be working good under.
What teams could you see him playing for then?
Well, I don't know. That's the thing.
Well, he still has one more year. So
yeah, it's hard.
We got a year to talk about.
Yeah, we have a while to talk about that yet. But also, I'm just saying right now, like, kind of how they did with Russell Wilson when he first came in Seattle, a lot of bootlegs getting the outside of the pocket.
Which they still run.
Yeah, so you got to get a guy like that outside of the pocket. Well, Wilson's more so because he's obviously shorter.
Yeah.
So he can't see over taller. Yeah.
Kitty cat.
Yeah. But, yeah, got to get him out of the pocket. I don't think he's really capable as a pocket passer just now. But, of course, he still has a year or two left in college, possibly. So maybe he can develop that here in the coming years. So as of right now, though, if you were to enter the draft today, I don't think he'll be too – he won't do too much, so that's where I'm coming from.
Yeah, I can see that, Corey. I mean, he obviously won the Heisman. He's the best college football player this year.
Yeah, but we've already seen the Heisman doesn't mean everything.
As I said, yeah, you look at past winners.
Look at past losers, actually.
Well, that as well, you know.
I mean, past losers have been just fine. Peyton Manning hasn't won a Heisman. He didn't win a Heisman, I guess.
Yeah.
Andrew Luck never won the Heisman. Yeah. Bunch of guys never won the Heisman in college, but still fine. Drew Brees is another one. Look what he's doing.
Yeah.
He has probably will probably end up having the best stats of any quarterback in the NFL at the pace he goes. He's gotten over 4,000 yards again for the 11th straight season. I mean, he's going to have probably the best stats of any quarterback. He might not be regarded as the best quarterback of all time, but he'll probably have the best stats in my
opinion. The biggest risk for signing a free agent, maybe, because with a shoulder injury. In San Diego, and then New Orleans takes a chance on him.
Yeah.
Obviously, it worked out because they won a Super Bowl. I can understand that too, Corey. You know, past losers, they've turned out. Now Deshaun Watson, he finished second. As you said, he declared for the NFL draft. A team say like the New York Jets, a team like the Chicago Bears, a team possibly like the Cleveland Browns. Teams that need quarterbacks, at least a backup quarterback, possibly a starter, you know, they could take Watson. He's going to be a first-round pick, probably top 15 pick. I could see him falling, though, into the late 20s, and then late in the first round, early second round. But, you know, we'll have to see how it plays out, you know, because draft is, hell, the season's not even over yet. We haven't even started bowl games. You know, these players have till, I believe, the middle of January to decide whether or not they're going to go to the NFL, if they're eligible to go to the NFL, meaning if they're a redshirt sophomore or, a true junior, or if they're a senior, they're obviously done in college then. So, we'll see how that plays out. We still got a lot of football to be played.
Yeah.
To talk about that. Going from college to the NFL.
Another team, the Niners, could probably use a quarterback as well.
Yeah, they could. I'm trying to think some other teams too. I mean, New Orleans, they could use a backup for Brees.
Yeah, they could get someone obviously.
They do have Luke McCown down there.
At the moment.
He's Josh McCown's brother. A really seasoned veteran in the league. And then they also have Garrett Grayson, who they drafted a couple years ago. He hasn't got a chance, obviously, because Brees is still playing some great football. Maybe a team like the Minnesota Vikings as well, because who knows what's going to happen if Teddy Bridgewater comes back. He's still got Sam Bradford.
Yeah.
You know, maybe you want to, you know, just start over. You trade both of those guys, and you get some... trade at least one. I said maybe two to get some other players in return on the offensive line, defense. You know, who knows what Peterson's going to be able to do after coming back from another ACL injury. So Minnesota could be another team. New England, Tom Brady's up there. They do have Garoppolo and Jacoby Brissett, who they just drafted this year.
Yeah, a couple young guys already. So,
but other than that, there's really no other teams that need quarterbacks.
That need one, per se, yeah.
So,
because, of course, Los Angeles Goff is still need to see how he turns out, of course.
He's been playing all right. I mean, the Rams, they started out strong, 3-1. They're 4-9 right now. They just fired Jeff Fisher yesterday. He's tied for the losingest coach in NFL history now. That's pretty sad, but there's surely nothing he can do about it now. He had the chance to win those games when they played him, and he lost them. Now, there's reports out there saying Jim Harbaugh is a perfect candidate for the LA Rams job. He's not going to leave Michigan, folks. I'm telling you. He's going to stay at Michigan until he dies or he's fired. There's no chance he's going to leave Michigan and go back to the NFL. I understand he did well in the NFL with the San Francisco 49ers. He was run out of San Francisco, though, and then he ended up in Michigan. So I could see him going back, though. I wouldn't be surprised if he does. He's a perfect coach for the LA atmosphere, I guess you could say. For all the noise, all the drama, you know how LA is. So I wouldn't be surprised if he does go back, but he's not going to leave Michigan. But if he did, he would turn the Rams around, I think, because you look what he did in San Francisco. The Rams, I mean, the 49ers absolutely sucked for how many years after Joe Montana and Steve Young until a long damn time. And then Harbaugh turned around, took him back to the Super Bowl. They lost to his brother in the Ravens with John Harbaugh by 3 points. And then 2 years after that, he gets run out and around San Francisco. And now he's in Michigan. So I wouldn't be shocked, but I don't think he's going to be leaving Michigan. To talk a little bit about that, since Jeff Fisher was hired, he was the first head coach and the NFL fired this year, certainly will not be the last. Rex Ryan's possibly on the hot seat. I wouldn't be surprised if Chip Kelly gets axed. John Fox in Chicago. Who else is there that could get fired in the NFL? I saw this morning Pete Carroll was a possible candidate for the LA Rams job. Now, will he leave San Francisco to go to LA, two teams in the same division? I don't think so. He'll be staying in Seattle until they fire him, or he decides to go back to college. There's really no one else. Marvin Lewis, the Bengals are having a bad year. I could see him getting fired. He's been there 13 years. But other than that, there's really no one else, I think, at the moment that could get fired. I don't know what you think about that.
Yeah, I don't think so. Not really.
Not really. No one that stands out.
Just some stretches.
Yeah.
That probably wouldn't, but I mean, they could.
But I mean, we've seen stuff in the past, though, that, coaches getting fired. Look at Lovie Smith a couple years ago. Yeah, he was doing a phenomenal job, no pun intended, for AJ Styles in Chicago, and then after 10 seasons, he gets fired.
Yeah.
You know?
Season after he made the playoffs.
Exactly.
Literally, like, lost in the playoffs, then he got fired somehow. It's weird. But, I mean, that's just how it goes sometimes, I guess.
I mean, it's a business. The NFL is a business.
Yeah, well, his problem was that he was constantly making the playoffs but not doing anything
in the playoffs.
He was making first round, and that was it.
You look at the Cincinnati Bengals. Perfect. Yeah. They're another perfect example.
Yeah, so yeah, I think Marvin Lewis might get the shaft.
And two African-American head coaches as well. So who knows if that leads to him getting fired, too.
Well, I don't think that should be a reason.
Well, I'm not saying that. It's just an example. Lovie Smith, as you said, they're making the playoffs, they're not winning. Marvin Lewis, they're doing the same thing in Cincinnati.
Well, yeah, this would be totally different, though, since the Bengals are not going to make the playoffs, it would appear.
Well, so, they've made the playoffs how many times in the past 5 years?
Yes, but at least they wouldn't fire him after making a playoff run, though. They'd be firing him, like, say, this season after doing a poor job this season. Yeah. So, I mean, it would be more justified than Lovie Smith's firing, is all I'm saying. Yeah, when you look at it. Yeah. But, of course, similar, I know what you're saying, it was similar in the fact that they've made the playoffs so many times but not done anything. So, I mean, I see where you're coming from.
All right. I think that's it about, because I rambled on there about Harbaugh going from college to the NFL, coaches getting fired. Let's go back to college, talk about the Heisman. I mean, we talked how Lamar won, how he, be in the NFL. But who else won awards this past week?
Well, Jackson won a couple more awards except for the Heisman. He won the Maxwell and the Water Camp Award, basically both most valuable players, essentially. Yep. But then Deshaun Watson, who came in second in the Heisman vote, and won the O'Brien Award, which is the best QB.
Yep.
So kind of weird when you look at it, because he won the best quarterback, but he's not the best player, despite the guy who won the Heisman, who's supposedly the best player, is also a quarterback. Kind of an interesting thing. I know after these awards came out, it was people were starting to question maybe Watson's going to win this Heisman, possibly. It made the race a little bit more contested.
Yeah, because these awards came out last Thursday, and the Heisman ceremony was this past Saturday night.
Yeah. The best running back in the country was not even on the of the five guys that got invited, Deontay Foreman. He won the Walker, the best running back in the country from Texas, over 2,000 yards, great season. I think he would have been deserving of being at least invited.
Yeah.
Perhaps, but
he,
of course.
He wasn't even that. He didn't even get that.
Yeah.
Now, he also declared for the NFL draft. He could be a possible first-round pick.
I think he...
He could be a three-down back in the NFL.
Yeah, but running backs are a different breed in terms of draft stock because you hardly see any running backs going in the first round.
The past couple years you haven't, yeah.
Yeah, but this year was a little different because, of course, Zeke Elliott went four overall. So, but nevertheless...
And you look what he's doing. He could be a... Could be the winner of the MVP, you know.
Possibly
rookie of the year as well.
Oh, I think he's running away with rookie of the year.
Along with Dak Prescott. Now, the Cowboys did lose to the Giants for the second time this year. They played week one, and then they played this past Sunday night. Zeke Elliott actually just lost his first away game since high school.
Yeah.
Never lost on the road in college and never lost in the NFL until this past weekend.
Pretty impressive when you think about it, I guess. Mm-hmm. But nevertheless, but yeah, back to Zeke Elliott just for a moment. He's, I think, running away with the rookie of the year, no pun intended, of course.
Yeah.
But yeah, I don't think there's anyone that's really going to be able to do it. Prescott's like the only one, but.
And the thing with that is they could cancel each other out because they play on the same team and they're both doing about the same, with total yards. Now, Elliott's going to have a little bit more because they run the ball a little bit more.
Well,
because he's a running back.
But actually, you would expect the quarterback to have more yards than a running back, though. Anyway.
Because he throws, yeah, that's what I'm saying, because he throws the ball.
Yeah.
So, I could see them canceling each other out, and then you got other MVP candidates, Derek Carr, Matthew Stafford.
Tom Brady,
he didn't even play for the first four games. He had a phenomenal game last night, no pun intended, again, for the AJ Styles hat. And then, Matt Ryan, he's sort of...
tapered off, I think, a little bit.
Yeah, because the Falcons, they did beat the Rams 42-14, which led to Jeff Fisher's firing this past weekend. But the Falcons, they're in a tight one now down in the NFC South with the Buccaneers,
yeah.
Who I said last week, I thought they would win the South and then make the playoffs. Now, they've won five straight. Last time they won five straight was 2002, and they won the Super Bowl that year. Against the Raiders, who are going back to the playoffs, more than likely.
Yeah, unless they somehow lose.
Unless something dramatically happens, because the AFC West race is also a tight one.
I think the Chiefs, they almost essentially have it wrapped up.
They do, because they beat the Raiders twice.
And they still about to play the Broncos one more time, but they already beaten the Broncos once. So, and they have a better division record than the Broncos anyway.
Yeah.
No matter whether they lose.
The Broncos are that team that could get left out of the playoffs.
I think they will.
And you look at past Super Bowl winners, those teams don't even make the playoffs. So this would keep going, you know, with that if the Broncos don't make the playoffs.
Yeah.
Going back to Matt Ryan, they're in a tight one now with Tampa. Tampa plays at Dallas on Sunday night, got flexed into the Sunday night game.
Yeah.
Because the Pittsburgh-Cincinnati game was supposed to be a Sunday night game this week, but now Cincinnati's 5-7-1. They're not doing as good as we said a little bit ago this year, which could lead to Marvin Lewis's firing. So that game got switched to the 1 o'clock slot this week.
We were talking about a college football award.
Yeah.
We were.
Well, you know us, though. We like to, you know, bullshit a little bit and ramble on about stuff.
Yeah. Going back now, another guy who was in that Heisman was invited to New York for the Heisman presentation, also won another award. The Blitnikoff for the wide receiver of the year, D.D. Westbrook, wins that one. He finished fourth in the Heisman voting, by the way. Of course, not very close to any of Watson or Jackson, of course.
And now that 3-4-5 spot in the Heisman. As you said, it's pretty much a two-man race this year.
Yeah. The Mackey Award for tight end of the year went to Jake Butt from Michigan, or Butte, I don't know how he says it.
It's Butt.
All right.
B-U-T-T.
The Outland, I think I have written down. if I'm reading that correctly.
The offensive lineman
for
of the year.
Interior lineman of the year, Cam Robinson out of Alabama.
Yeah.
The Remington for center of the year, Pat Elfline from Ohio State. I don't know why I put the Groza for kicker of the year, but Zane Gonzalez from Arizona State.
He broke the what did he break this year? I remember watching the game. Most points, I believe, or it was most, it had been most points by a kicker in college football history. All right. So he's a pretty damn good kicker.
The Bednarik for defensive player of the year, Jonathan Allen out of Alabama. So, I don't know. Yeah, I think he squeezed in there in the Heisman.
In the
voting.
Heisman?
In the top 10 voting, at least.
Yeah, he finished 7th.
Yeah, so.
If I look at that paper.
Jabril Peppers, who got invited, didn't even win that award. So, interesting. No. Best defensive player. But he also, Jonathan Ellis won the Nagurski.
Yep.
For, I didn't put down what it was. I think it's the same thing, though. I think defensive player of the year.
Yes, the Nagurski is defense guy.
Yeah, okay. And then the Home Depot were for best for coach of the year, Mike McIntyre from Colorado.
Yeah,
great season.
He's turned the bus around after leaving, I believe it was UNLV after a couple years. And as I say, he turned their program around. Colorado hasn't been good since 2005 when they played Texas. The year Texas won the national title in the Big 12 championship game. And he turned around. Expect more to come. From Colorado here in the near future.
All right, those are all the awards I put down. I don't think it's not all of them though.
That's pretty much all the main headliner ones that you need to know about. With college football awards, I actually forgot the award ceremony was on. I knew about the Heisman, but I forgot about the award ceremony. It's always the Thursday before the Heisman ceremony, and I got a hold of him and I said, well, maybe we should talk about that as well. So we decided to put it in the show today.
All right. Yeah, that's why it's in there. But if that's all you got, then we're going to have to move on to some NFL now. Already gotten into somewhat a little bit.
Yeah, that's all I have for college kids, because as we said, there's only one game in the FBS, and we already talked about some FCS games, and we picked our winners for the 9 bowl games within the next week. As I said, we're going to be taking it 1 week at a time. Just because it's a little easier that way rather than doing them all at once. And, of course, if we want to change our mind, we can by that point. So it makes it a little bit easier on us. So we got 9 bowl games, as I said, within the next week from this Saturday until next Wednesday night. And then, we'll move on to the NFL now.
All right, moving on to the NFL. I gotta say it was a pretty good week in the NFL. A lot of close games.
It was.
This week.
And we knew that. We knew that. Going in, we said it last week, it could have been the best week in the NFL so far this year.
Well, if I remember correctly, I was
previewing the games.
Well, if I remember last week, I said it was the best probably slate of the primetime games, the Thursday, the Sunday night, and Monday night games.
Well, I liked a lot of the Sunday day games as well.
They ended up being good. Some of them weren't as good on paper, but they did end up being good in the end, but nevertheless. So we'll get into it. Upset of the week. I had the Titans over the Broncos being the closest thing I saw to an upset for the most part.
Well, I picked the Titans, so I can't call that an upset. The Giants over the Cowboys, a lot of people are going to say, because the Giants are the only team to beat the Cowboys this year. They've beat them twice, and possibly that could win the Giants the NFC East. If the Cowboys stumble, they play the Buccaneers this Sunday night at home, who have won 5 straight. And then they also, I believe, Dallas has to play Philly and Washington.
They played Washington twice already.
Well, I know they're going to play Philly then.
Philly's last
and
week
then,
of the season.
And then
I forget who they play.
They play somebody else. They got one more game after that. So a lot of people are going to say that because the Giants, as I said, only team to beat the Cowboys. But then the Packers or the Seahawks. I know I picked the Packers, but the Seahawks didn't even show up to that game.
Not really, no.
Russell Wilson threw 5 interceptions. They looked absolutely horrible.
Yeah, they haven't looked
too good. They looked like, let's say, a high school team, because the Rams looked like a middle school team, as Todd Gurley said.
All right. But yeah, the Seahawks, 5 turnovers by Wilson all through the air. And then, they haven't been good on the road all season. They've lost a lot of bad games on the road.
No.
They only scored 5 in Tampa Bay. They lost early in the season to the Rams, only scored like 3 or 6 points or something like that. I think it was six. They lost 9-6.
Yes.
To the Rams early on in the season.
I believe it was second or third week of the year, yeah.
They have, and even the first, well, that was a home game the first week of the season. They only scored about 13 or something, barely beating the Dolphins.
Yep.
But they haven't looked good on the road all season.
No, and I think the reason why they looked like this past week, and especially in Tampa, this is their third, about halfway, the whole way across the country, road game of the year. They had to go to New England, which they won, and then, as you said, they lost to Tampa, and now Seattle. You know, that affects the players. You know, they got to get rest.
Yeah.
And then, especially going back to the West Coast, you know, I know they're 3 hours behind, but still, that it affects everybody. Yeah. You know, on, you know, play calls, how the players play. You know, I should have called this call rather than that. You know, that goes back to the Super Bowl when they should have ran the ball on it. But the Seahawks, they'll probably still win the West. The Cardinals stumbled.
They basically already have. They just need to win a game, or the Cardinals need to lose one more game,
yes,
which is easy to happen.
Which should have happened this past week if they would have beat the Packers, because the Cardinals lost to the Dolphins.
It's not a huge upset, but yeah, Titans over the Broncos, I think. And I thought it was the closest thing to an upset that I saw, so it's not like 100%. But you talk about the Cowboys and Giants. Question here. In your opinion, did the Cowboys disappoint, or did the Giants were impressive? Which do you think was the case?
Now, a lot of people are going to say the weather had a lot. It impacted that game a lot. But really, it was just cold. You know, there wasn't the fog at the beginning of the game because of the fireworks. But Dak, he didn't throw to Dez enough, I thought. Dez only had one catch, and then he fumbled it at the end of the game.
He had about 8 or 9 targets, though. So he did throw it to him.
Well, that's Dez's fault. That's Dez's fault, then. He should have caught it. I think the Cowboys disappointed, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
I don't think they can. Because the final score is 10-7, folks.
Yeah.
You know, it wasn't 35-0.
Yeah.
You know, it's not like Eli Manning had the best game of his career. It was 10-7. And hell, it was 7-0 at halftime. You know, the Giants did shut him out in the second half. You know, their defense wins championships. You know, their defense stepped up there in the second half, and as I said, they shut them out and they won the game. But the Cowboys disappointed. In that game, they didn't disappoint for me personally, but because they had their chances to win that game, they didn't.
I'm sure a lot of people are going to say the Cowboys disappointed, but I think the Giants were pretty impressive, if you ask me. Had three turnovers, forced three turnovers, two picks of Dak, and then one fumble from Dez Bryant, as you already mentioned. Yeah. They held the Cowboys to only 260 total yards, and they averaged about 385 a game, the Cowboys do. So they held them really low. The defense played really well, is basically where I'm coming from. They also won the time of possession battle, which the Cowboys have done pretty much all season because of the way they run the ball, the Cowboys do. So they took that away from the Cowboys, not allowing them to control the clock as much. Also held Dallas to 1-15 on third down conversions, which is only like 6% or something like that. And they got three sacks on Prescott. They pressured him a lot, especially late in the game.
Yeah.
They got a lot of pressure on him, made him hurry his throws some, not allow him to make easy throws to some guys. You know, he had a lot of errant throws because of the pressure by that Giants front four or seven, if you want to say. But I think the Giants came out with a good defensive scheme, you could say. And I think it's their defense that really was impressive in that game, holding the high-powered Dallas offense to just 7 points. I mean, of course, on the flip side, the Cowboys did hold the Giants to just 10, but and really, they only held the Giants to one touchdown, basically, just one 60-yard touchdown, so it was basically one play game that decided the game, so.
Yeah, Odell Beckham's long run. Because Eli only threw it, 10 yards, maybe?
Yeah.
And Beckham did the rest.
So, basically, they lost that game just on one play, essentially.
Yeah, that's true.
And I mean, of course, all the times that the Giants late in the game, especially in the fourth quarter, shut them down themselves. They shut down Zeke in the fourth quarter and did not allow Dak to make some easy, good throws.
Yeah.
Because Dak was forced to hold on to the ball a lot.
He was, yeah.
He had to hold on to it. They played good.
What'd you say? How many sacks?
three sacks.
So
I think mostly early in the game, but late in the game, the corners were playing really tight up on their guys, I guess, and Dak had to hold on to the ball for a little too long. They got pressure to him, wasn't allowing him to make good throws. So, I mean, that makes the difference, and it did in that game, I think. So
I'd agree with that. Now, if I was Tampa, you know, as I said, Tampa plays at Dallas, you do what the Giants did both times they played them this year,
because
they're the only team to beat the Cowboys this year.
Well, the Buccaneers had a good defensive game this past week against the Saints.
Yeah.
Held Drew Brees to under 300 and no touchdown. They didn't have a single offensive touchdown the Saints did, actually.
And it was Brees, what was it, the first time in, well, no, that was last week.
Second straight game.
Second straight game he has not thrown a touchdown. Second straight game he's thrown three interceptions as well, first time in his career. But then the stat last week, first time he didn't throw a touchdown pass in, what, 4 years?
Something.
It was something crazy.
Well, last week it was in home games.
I thought it was overall.
No.
I thought they said it was overall.
That streak was broken a long time.
All right.
From last season, that streak was broken. But it was like 60 straight home games he had, and he has thrown a touchdown pass dating back to, well, last week against the Lions. So yeah, it would have been like about 4 years or so, because he only played about 8 games a season at home. So
yeah.
It would be a couple years since he hasn't thrown a touchdown at home. But yeah, 2 straight games with no touchdowns for Drew Brees, unheard of. But the Bucs play the way they did this past week defensively, then they have a real shot.
You could see the Cowboys losing for the second straight week.
That's a theme that's been happening in football in general, even college, because look at a team like Stanford. They lost their one game to Washington, lost a bunch of games. Even Michigan State, who had a terrible season, starting with a blowout loss to Wisconsin early in the season for their first loss. And then the NFL, the Broncos started the undefeated, lost a couple games in a row. The Packers lost 4 straight after starting off really good. The Vikings lost 3 or 4 straight after starting 5-0. So,
they're 6-7 now.
Yeah, losing. No, they're 7-6.
They did one this past week.
But losing streaks after being on a really hot streak have been kind of a theme this season.
True.
So, possibly. Not going to give any spoilers out, although we'll be picking that game later when we get to it. But, yeah, I guess moving on now. If I don't have anything else, best game for me. I put the Dolphins over the Cardinals. Game-winning field goal. Exciting game.
Yeah.
Close game. There's a whole bunch of games I could have put in this slide. I just put that one in. That was the one that jumped out to me because of what happened in the game. I guess late. Exciting. A little bit more exciting, I guess. But almost every game this week was pretty much one possession.
That's what I said a little bit ago. Tannehill, the Dolphins, I think they would have won by a better margin if he wouldn't have got hurt. Now, who knows if they're going to make the playoffs now, you know, with Matt Moore being their quarterback. Now, Matt Moore is another experienced veteran backup quarterback. So he could lead them, you know, to the playoffs, but they need some help, though. They're in the hunt, you know, because you got Oakland and Denver as the 2 wildcard teams right now.
Yeah.
Because Kansas City had beat Oakland. So Oakland fell from 2-5. From losing that Kansas City game. And that game, that was my best game, I thought. You know, Kansas City got up. Oakland wasn't really playing that well. And then Oakland started to come back, but it was a little too late. Now, a lot of people were saying, well, the ball hit the camera that they run across the field. And there's always that, it's on a string. It's the line that connects the two cameras from like end zone to end zone. And a lot of people were saying that ball hit that, and then that's why the pass from Derek Carr to Amari Cooper was off target. Now, I don't know if that's true or not. I have seen it. It didn't really look like it, but there really wasn't a clear picture that you could tell. So could have factored into it. And then say the Raiders score on that drive, they tie the game. Who knows if that game goes to overtime then?
Well, they need the 2-point conversion, though, of course.
Well, still, it would have made it a lot more interesting than, you know, what it was. So, the Raiders fought. They did lose. They lost to the Chiefs a second time this year. So, that was the best game for me.
I have a hard time getting behind that game because it was... The final score was settled in the third quarter, early in the third quarter. It was 21-13 throughout the third quarter and the rest of the game. No team scored for the last, like, 2 quarters almost.
Yeah.
So not much happened in the later. I mean, there's some interesting moments, of course. I mean, you just brought one up. But, yeah, but I have a hard time getting behind that game because it wasn't, like, exciting the whole way, I don't think. for me. But yeah, it was a good game though, big game as well. Impressed this week. I put the Titans impressive, and they're a team that I think could maybe make waves in the playoffs, perhaps if they make it that far.
I think they got to win the South.
Well, they have to win the South. I'm saying if they can win the South, they're tied right now. So, and they played the Texans last week of the season. Yeah. So they could definitely do it, but I think the Titans could do something. They could win a playoff game if they make it. They would have a home game, of course, since they're going to have to win the South more than likely to do it. But they're very good offensively. They rank in the top 10 in both points a game and yards a game. They also have the third best rushing attack in
the NFL. Yeah, that's why they're at where they're at right now, is because of their running game with DeMarco Murray and Derrick Henry. And then Mariota, he can run the ball too. So
yeah, that two-headed monster with Henry and Murray, really good. But they average 144.5 yards a game. Only Buffalo and Dallas rank above them in that category. And then defensively, they also have the third best rushing defense in the league at only 86.6 yards a game. So they'll be able to shut down running backs. And that was a big key for why they won against Denver, because Denver needs their running attack to do well to win most of the time.
I think Tennessee's going back to what they know best when they were winning, when they had Steve McNair and Eddie George as their quarterback and running back in the late 2000s, back in the late 90s, early 2000s, when Jeff Fisher, who just got fired by the Rams, was their head coach. And Mike Mularkey, you know, he's coached under Fisher. You know, as I said, go back to that, you win.
Yeah.
You know, and it works. So, Murray, now, if he would be playing in Tennessee his whole career, who knows? Tennessee could have been in this position a couple years ago, and who knows if Brock Osweiler would be in Houston. Who knows if Jacksonville would probably be about the same. But who knows about Indy, you know? Because you look at Andrew Luck, they were good his first 2 years, and then three years, and then he got hurt last year. So who knows if Tennessee could have contended with Indy whenever Indy had won in Luck's early years there, and possibly could have beat somebody in the playoffs who won the Super Bowl. Now, I really don't want to get into that, but I really don't want to, you know, conspiracy theory this, conspiracy theory that, but, you know, and who knows if Murray would have came over a year earlier rather than going to Philly, you know, if that would have made even more of a difference. But Tennessee, they're going back to their old habits, and it's working for them.
Yeah.
They're in their second year. You know, they're the top two picks last year. It could hurt them.
Yeah.
Because they're young.
Yeah, that's my only problem with them. Mariota throwing the ball. They have the 25th ranked offensive passing game in the NFL, so he's not doing too much there. But also, the other problem, the bigger problem, I think, is they have the 31st ranked passing defense in the NFL.
Yeah, their secondary is awful.
And
they're really on the offense side of the ball, the reason why they're, what did you say, 25th?
Yeah.
Who do they have? Who do they throw the ball to? Yeah. They have Delanie Walker's their tight end.
Yeah.
That sticks out in my mind. Who are their wide receivers?
Well, they have Rashard Matthews, I know.
He's all right. Who else? Nobody.
They don't have anybody really, like, noteworthy, though.
Exactly. Exactly what you're saying. If Tennessee had a good number one receiver, who knows? They could have clinched the South by now.
Perhaps.
Or that, you know, passing would be ranked higher than what it is at 25 right now.
Yeah, and that's really going to hurt them, that 31st ranked defense, because to do well in the playoffs, you're going to have to get through a guy like, so say they're four, they could play a team like, say, the Steelers with Ben Roethlisberger, or even the Raiders with Derek Carr, and especially Tom Brady, if you make it that far,
yep,
those guys are going to carve you up. So, yep. And that's going to be really hard for them to do something. But if they play a team like the Broncos, they can easily do it, because they can just do what they did this past week, shut down the run game, which is what the Broncos need, and it just works into their system perfectly. Mm-hmm. Force Trevor Siemian to make throws, but nevertheless, I think the Titans could do something. But who impressed you this week? Anyone?
Not really anybody that stood out. I mean, as you said earlier, there's a lot of good games, a lot of teams that could contend for the spot, yeah, but no one really stood out because, as you said too, there's a lot of close games.
Yeah.
You know, no one really blew anybody out other than the Packers over the Seahawks. I picked the Packers, so, and I said a couple weeks ago, you know, I think they'll win the North, you know, after losing four straight. Now they're what on a two-game win streak. So yeah, they're 2-4 in their past six games. So you could say Green Bay just because they blew out Seattle, but other than that, no one really impressed me because, as I said, there's a lot of close games. Yeah. No one blew anybody out by a lot.
Disappointed. I didn't really have much of anything for disappointed, but I went with one team as a whole through the entire season. It's Jacksonville Jaguars. They've lost 8 straight games.
Yeah,
they're 2-11. This is a team that you and I were both pretty high on.
Yeah, along with the Raiders, I had the Raiders and the Jaguars as my two wild card teams this year. And right now, I'm more than likely going to get one of those teams right.
Yeah, but they're a team that we were both kind of high on. Maybe think they could even contend or even win their division possibly this season.
Yeah.
But they have all the talent in the world too, but just 8 straight losses, 2-11. They're contending for the number one pick at the moment, although the Browns seem to have that locked up essentially.
Well, the Browns will have the number one pick because I don't know if they'll win a game. Now, they might beat the Chargers next weekend, but we'll have to see about that. They could beat the Bills.
They're going to beat the Steelers.
No, they won't beat the Steelers. What was I going to say?
All they need is one.
Oh, but Tennessee really filled in for Jacksonville in that spot, then I guess you could say. You know, because Tennessee's in contention for the wild card. Even for the division. So I just picked the wrong team. I thought Tennessee would have had another not as good year as what they've projected to be. So disappointed for me. On the flip side of that, somewhat impressive for the Packers, because I really didn't think anybody, it'd be the Seahawks. Yeah. Because Russell Wilson, and most importantly Russell Wilson, because he threw 5 picks, and we talked about it a little bit ago.
Yeah, that's an awful game right there. And of course, he was able to pad some of his stats later in the game because the game was over.
Yeah.
And that always happens. You see guys just getting touchdowns or something late in the game because the defense doesn't care. They're up by 30 or whatever. Yeah. So no one cares anymore at that point. A couple of questions here. Just a couple of questions. We brought this up earlier. We might as well bring it in again, get in more into it. But thanks to the loss to the Titans, how hurt are the Broncos' playoff chances with that loss?
A lot. I don't think, as we said, I don't think they're going to make the playoffs now. Because the AFC West is so tight.
Yeah.
Now, with New England beating Baltimore last night on Monday Night Football, it helps Pittsburgh. But then you also have the Miami Dolphins.
Yeah.
You know, also in the East. That could be in the wild card hunt.
And that's also why the Titans only really have a shot at the division, because they have to get through teams like Dolphins and Ravens and also the Broncos again, which they have the head-to-head too, though. But they need to get through those other teams. There's only one spot, really. Because the Raiders pretty much, or the AFC West runner-up basically, is going to have the fifth seed, essentially, already racked up, essentially.
Yeah. Okay, yeah.
So, I mean, it's going to be really tough for, well, going back to the Broncos itself, they're having a very hard time making the playoffs because they have the toughest schedule remaining. Because they play the Patriots next week here, then they play the Chiefs and the Raiders. They play the three best teams in the AFC to finish their season. And they're going to have to go to Arrowhead.
What are they, 8-5?
They're
8-4 going into last. This past week they lost 8-5. They're going to finish 8-8. They won't make playoffs. And as I said, the previous Super Bowl teams that have won, they don't make playoffs.
I see them finishing 9-7. I think they're going to beat the Raiders in the last week of the season. I think they're going to lose to the Patriots this coming week, and then the Chiefs, because I think, if I'm not mistaken, it is an Arrowhead against the Chiefs.
Yeah, because Kansas City already played at Denver. Yeah.
So, I think the Chiefs, I think, have the AFC West pretty much. I think they're going to do it because they play.
Because they beat Oakland both times.
Yeah, they beat Oakland both times. They play Tennessee this week, and then they have to play the Chargers last week of the season as well.
Don't forget about those Chargers, though. I mean, there's a lot that can happen, and there's a possibility that the Chargers could sneak in and be the sixth seed in the AFC playoffs. They need a lot of help, and they got to win out.
Yeah.
There's a possibility that the Chargers can make the playoffs.
Yes. However unlikely.
But who knows? The Browns could beat them next week, as I said. So, and if you lose to the Browns, you don't even deserve to be in the NFL.
Wow.
The Browns are the worst team ever.
Maybe not go that far. You don't want to say that, and then if the Steelers somehow do lose, then you'll be looking, then you won't
hate
saying that.
Oh yeah, I'd go back on my word then.
Of course. But
yeah. I think any team, team fan, or whatever fan of the team you like, and you say that, I think anybody would go back saying that. Just because it's the Browns. Now, if it was somebody like the Houston Texans or like the Chicago Bears, that's different. The Browns are the Browns. They're awful.
Yeah.
They're awful.
Also, Denver, I mean, their chances do get a little bit better thanks to no Ryan Tannehill in Miami for maybe a little bit here.
Yeah.
Because they're going to need to win games. Maybe they won't be able to win some of these games down the line with Matt Moore, as we've already kind of talked about a little bit. So that helps them. But then the Ravens, of course, can come up and win that. Or even if they overtake the Steelers, because they do play the Steelers again.
On Christmas Day.
Yeah, if they win that, then they have the head-to-head to the Steelers in the division. So if they can somehow...
And then Pittsburgh would be fighting for that 5-6 spot in the wild card. Yeah,
and then, of course, also you have Tennessee as well. Even Buffalo, if you want to talk about teams that have an outside shot. Because
Buffalo, I think Buffalo had to win this past week, which they didn't.
Yeah.
To get people talking about them more.
Well, I think they do play the Jets again.
They're still on the hunt, as I said. The Bills and the Chargers are about the same spot.
Well, if I'm not mistaken, the Bills would have to play, I think they do have to play the Jets again. They play the Browns as well.
They play the Browns this week.
Yeah. So they can win those two games. They'll be at 8-7. And last week they play probably Miami because they've already played New England twice, of course. So I probably think it would be Miami because every game week 17 is a divisional game, of course. So it would be Miami, I do believe. So they can
win. A lot of these games the next 3 weeks are all divisional games. The NFL, yeah. The NFL set it up like that this year to make it a little bit more interesting. They typically do, as you said, but hasn't been like this the past couple years. We got a lot of comments, I think, on there. Well, because it was snowing out, and because of the weather, Ryan Young, and you know, a little hard to throw the ball in that type of weather. Roethlisberger still had a good game.
Three picks though.
Well. He still had good. Then that's another reason why they were running the ball a lot. You know, would you want to put it in his hands? I'd want to put it in his hands if it came down to it at the end. Yeah, Buffalo started to come back. Pittsburgh ended up winning by 7. But at the same time, I'm a little mad about Bell racking up almost 300 total yards because he made me lose in fantasy football playoffs this past week. And that team was my best team this year. I went 10-3 in the regular season. I lose in the first round of the playoffs because Le'Veon Bell put up almost 300 total yards and 3 touchdowns.
Yeah, I mean, that's what you got to do with the snow. That's normally what happens. You run the ball a lot more in the snow.
And he's a receiving back, so he can catch the ball out of the backfield and do what he does best.
Yeah, it's a little harder to run some routes in the snow, so... Throwing the ball is a little bit of a challenge.
Yeah.
And also, if it is snowing, also, that also hurts ball flight and stuff like that. If we're going to get technical, I guess, I would say.
Ouch.
For your fantasy team.
Yeah.
Oh, boy. Last one. Since the Patriots did win, are they the best team in the NFC? Are they favorites to win the AFC this season?
The Patriots?
The Patriots. Did you have the one game lead over the Chiefs?
To win the AFC and get in the Super Bowl? Is that what you mean?
Favorites are the best in the AFC?
Or be the number one seed?
Well, either or. I'm saying, are they the best in the AFC or are they favorites? Like, it can be a two-part question almost, if you want to make it that. But they are one game up on the Chiefs right now for the top spot. Technically, one game up on the Raiders as well, because the Raiders are technically just one game behind. But
the game I'd like to see would be, it had to be in the AFC title game. If the Patriots and Chiefs were the 1 and 2 seed, would be a rematch of that divisional game last year. Because Kansas City almost beat New England. And then Denver ended up beating New England in the AFC title game and beat Carolina in the Super Bowl.
Oh, no, taking the wrong game. Sorry.
So I'd really like to see that rematch. But I don't really think there's a really clear-cut team right now that could win either conference to win the Super Bowl. All these teams are about the same, if you ask me right now.
Well, I think it's more so in the NFC, in my opinion, who's going to come out of there, especially the way the Cowboys have been playing the last couple weeks. Haven't been putting up many points. They have played pretty good defenses in Minnesota and New York. Yeah. I mean, New York's not a great defense overall, but they played a good defensive game on Sunday, of course. Mm-hmm. But they haven't been putting up too much lately. And that might hurt them here going down the end of the season and even into the playoffs. But, I mean, they have the formula to do well in the playoffs, but maybe we'll get into the NFC here. About, I have a comment about the Cowboys' chances, so we'll get into that real quick. But I think that the Chiefs are the one team that could probably dethrone the Patriots. The way they don't have the flashiest numbers as a team.
Andy Reid knows what he's doing, though.
He's a very experienced coach. I think he's a third team that can do well. They turn the ball over a lot against other teams. They have, I think I saw 5 defensive touchdowns on the year, a couple more special teams touchdowns, so they're getting it elsewhere sometimes.
Maybe we see a rematch of Super Bowl I and Super Bowl 51, 50 years later, between the Kansas City Chiefs and the Green Bay Packers.
Right, stretching, but
if the Packers can make the playoffs, but that is stretching it.
Because the Packers are on a tight rope, because the Lions are very, very close to clinching. All they need is a win, and the Packers lost this week.
Those two teams play each other the last week of the season, so who knows what can happen there.
But I think the Chiefs, they've shown this season that they can definitely compete with anybody and win any game. But also the Raiders, they probably have a team that, like, eye test, just looking at, like, their stats and stuff, do have a really good chance, because they are one of the best offensive teams in the league. But also, they're one of the, I wouldn't say, they are kind of the worst in the bottom third of pretty much every category in defense. But they do force a lot of turnovers. I think they have 24 total turnovers to only 9 turnovers that they are, I guess, if we're doing actual terms, they have 24 takeaways and 9 giveaways for a turnover difference about 15. So for what they make up for in their lack of defense, they make up for in turnovers. So the Raiders is another team that could. Their problem is they're likely going to be in the wild card and have to play road games. I think that'll hurt them. And also, they would more than likely have to play Tom Brady and the Patriots in Foxborough. I don't know how they'll fare too well in that game because they're...
Who knows if it's going to be snowing again.
Could be snowing as well.
Just like the
in a January day in
Tuck Roll game.
Boston, so, or Massachusetts.
Foxborough.
But Raiders or Chiefs could dethrone them. Of course, there's always the chance that the Broncos could somehow with their defense. Otherwise, I think the NFC North and South winners, or even if one of the other teams from the North makes the wild card, I don't think they're going to be able to. The Steelers, maybe. They're, I think, more of a long shot out of those 4 teams to be the favorite. They're not, I would put into the favorite category, but...
Yeah, they probably have one of the best offenses in the NFL.
Yeah.
With Roethlisberger, Bell, and Brown.
Yeah.
And Ladarius Green, he's starting to, play a little better since he's returned from injury.
But yeah. NFC, though, I know the comment we got is, what are the Cowboys' chances of winning it all? I mean, if you look at it, they look like a really good chance. The way they play the game... Just how they do it. They run the ball a lot. They eat up time of possession. Yeah. I think they're second in the league in time of possession, only behind Philly in time of possession, which is kind of weird when you think about it. Philly's tops in the league in time of possession, when just a few years ago under Chip Kelly, they were the lowest in time of possession. So they're kind of changing things around there with Peterson and coach. But the Cowboys, the way they play, but my concern right now is how they played the last couple weeks, as I already mentioned.
Yeah. I mean... The only thing about it is, though, the regular season and the playoffs, they're two different seasons, if you ask me. Yeah. Because come playoff time, these teams know, and these players know, you win or you're done.
Yeah.
The Cowboys, they do have a good chance. They do have to play a little bit better. But the last time they started... I believe it was 8-1 or 9-1. I told you this a couple weeks ago. They lost in the playoffs. And this year they started 8-1. So it's not really looking good if you look at that. But who knows who they're going to play in the playoffs.
Yeah.
They could play anybody from Detroit, Green Bay, Seattle, Arizona. They're in the mix as well. They could still get a wild card.
They can, but I think they're done.
You got the Giants, and you also got the Redskins, two teams that are in their division.
And then they're going to have a week off more so, than likely, though, before those games.
Yeah.
So, and it's going to be likely a home game because, I mean...
Well, if they're a 1 or 2 seed, they get a home game in the divisional, yeah.
Yeah. Well, they're likely going to have home field the whole way unless they lose a couple games here down the stretch because they are 2 up already on what is Detroit.
And then Detroit the would top. Have home field.
So, they'd have... I mean, a win
for
this
the
week.
First time in how long? Forever. Yeah. It seems like when was the last time Detroit had home field in playoffs? When was the last time Detroit...
I don't think ever, actually.
Because they played at Dallas a couple years ago and they made the playoffs for the first time in how long?
And if the last time Dallas made the playoffs is any indication, they had a similar system then with Murray and Romo. They should be doing pretty well if they keep that up because they were one Dez Bryant catch away from winning against Green Bay and going to Seattle for the conference championship game that season.
But, now, a lot of people were saying, too, and we haven't talked about this yet because you just brought up Tony Romo's name. Should the Cowboys start Tony Romo now over Dak Prescott since they lost twice to the Giants?
Well, knowing Jerry Jones, I feel like they lose this week, they might start Tony Romo the following week. Because just how Jerry Jones, how much he loves Tony Romo, I think that the way Dak has been playing the last couple of weeks, and if they lose 2 straight, they might want to put in Romo just because they're just so high on Romo.
Yeah, and then that would come down to them possibly getting home field is what we just talked about.
Yeah, and Tony does have more experience. I think, I don't want to say you would want Romo, but...
Well, he obviously has more experience, Dak, on your rookie.
Well, yeah, what I'm saying, like, you kind of want Romo in a sense because of that experience with the playoffs and stuff. You don't know how Dak's going to handle the playoffs, the pressure of the playoffs, because being a rookie...
Well, that, and as I said, it's 2 different times, 2 different seasons, if you ask me. You
teams
know,
play a lot harder.
Exactly. So, they should keep Dak right now, but if they lose to Tampa, I think they do need to switch to Romo. But that will come down to a game time decision on who's going to play. They're obviously both going to dress. Romo's been dressed in the past couple weeks since he's been back. But they'll keep it. They'll keep people waiting to see who they will start if it comes down to that.
All right, we're going to go back to another question we kind of already went over a little bit again.
Okay.
We just got it right now.
All right.
Who do you think is going to win the NFL MVP? So we kind of brought this up a little bit. You mentioned Zeke.
I mentioned Ezekiel Elliott, Dak Prescott, Derek Carr, Matthew Stafford, Matt Ryan, and Tom Brady. And the weird thing about Brady is he didn't even play for the first 4 games of the year. And he's he's putting up numbers. Never has before. The thing with Zeke and Dak, I think they could cancel each other out just because they're both playing so damn good and they're on the same team. Now, if they're on different teams, say Dak was playing for the other Texas team in Houston as their quarterback, and then Zeke was in Dallas, now you got a good conversation there. You're still going to have a good conversation with him now.
I don't think
you do. But who knows how Dak would be playing if he was in Houston or any other team.
Well, even now, Zeke's definitely playing way better than Prescott, especially over the last couple of games.
Yeah.
Because Prescott wasn't that great here on Sunday night. Only 160-some yards, touchdown, 2 picks. Zeke had still had a 100-yard game.
Well, it's because of that offensive line. That's the reason why they're doing so good.
Yeah, but then the offensive line kind of let him down with all that pressure on Prescott late in the game from the Giants front 4. But nevertheless, I think it's not...
But as I said, defense wins championships.
I don't think Prescott's in that mix for MVP, though, anymore. I don't think Prescott should be in that mix for MVP anymore. I think it's...
Who would win Rookie of the Year, then, between the two of them?
Well, easily Zeke, considering if Zeke's going to be in the MVP race, then he's got to be winning Rookie of the Year. I think he's already won Rookie of the Year, if you ask me.
Okay.
You might as well say. No one else has really done much other than Prescott. Wentz, early on, you could argue, but he has kind of dropped off a lot lately, of course.
Yeah.
So he's the only other one. But MVP, I said it the first time I got this question weeks ago. I said Tom Brady. Keep it on Tom Brady because he's playing for what's the best team. Tied now for the best team in the league, record-wise. Didn't even play the first 4 games, but still lighting it up. Played a great last night. Had 400 yards or so, like 3 touchdowns, I think it was. Another great game against a tough team in Baltimore at home on Monday night. So, but also, I mean, Derek Carr could. I think he's the another one. But I think Matthew Stafford's a dark horse in that conversation because the way the Lions are playing this season, I don't think a lot of people had the Lions doing this well this season. Possibly winning the NFC North here, maybe even this weekend when they play the Giants.
With 2 weeks to go.
Yeah, if they win this week and the Packers lose, they win the North, I think, because they've beaten the Vikings twice already. Mm-hmm. So if the Vikings were to tie them, it doesn't matter. And with 2 weeks to go, that's the best the Vikings could do if the Lions win. So Matthew Stafford's a guy that could maybe even – he might even win like – well, I don't know. He wouldn't probably win comeback player of the year because he wasn't bad last season, of course. But
– no.
Is Jim Caldwell still a coach?
I
think he might win coach of the year unless
– Garrett. Jason Garrett.
No. Isn't Del Rio the coach in Oakland?
Oakland, yeah.
Yeah, I think Del Rio.
Chuck Del Rio.
In Oakland will win coach of the year, but that's not what we're talking about. But still, I think it's Tom Brady's to basically lose, I think. I think he's going to win it. Although that four-game suspension beginning of the year might hurt him in the voting. So.
Yeah, but then if he does win, people are going to have an uproar about it because he was suspended.
And, yeah, but you can't really argue if he has the numbers to back it up and the resume to back it up.
That is true.
So, I mean, the numbers speak for themselves. And if he's the best player, I mean,
why not?
You got to give it to him. That's the name of the award. You got to give it to the best player. So that's all we had, and it's all we've gotten. So that's all I had for those questions. So now it's time for us to get into our picks for this week.
Yep.
Slew of eight games. We got a Saturday night game this week, but we're not going to start with that. We're going to start with a Thursday night game, and we're going to be in a general consensus here. It's going to be the Seahawks defeating the Rams in Seattle. Rams suck. Seattle's at home. They don't lose at home. I think that's all we really need to say about that game for the most part.
Yeah.
The freaking Rams interim head coach is their special teams coach.
Yeah.
So, and he doesn't really have much experience being a head coach at all. So that's not really going to help.
No.
And you have to go to Seattle the week after. It's
on Thursday night.
On Thursday night. Short week.
Yes.
New coach.
Yes.
Terrible offense against a good defensive team at home.
Yes.
It's going to be the Seahawks. And everyone's going to pick the Seahawks in that game. Saturday night game.
Don't be surprised if the Rams pull the upset, though.
Watch it happen. Yeah. But Dolphins Jets play on Saturday night, first Saturday night game of the season.
Yeah.
At least some more of the following.
Next Saturday, Christmas Eve, December 24th, we'll have every game that's normally played on a Sunday, except for the Chiefs and Broncos. The Steelers and the Ravens, and then the Monday night game that week, which I believe it's the Lions and the Cowboys. I think that that's the other team the Cowboys have to play, or the Detroit Lions.
Oh.
They play on Monday night that week.
That's a really good game.
Yeah. So every other game, the NFL will be on a Saturday all next week, and then you got the two Christmas games. For the first time in, I don't know how long, since the NFL's played on Christmas. And then you got the Monday night game, the day after December 26th. So, yeah, we got one Saturday night game this week, and then the rest of them are next week.
All right. So, Dolphins-Jets, who are you taking in that game?
I'm going to take the J-E-T-S, Jets. Dolphins, Matt Moore has said he's an experienced veteran quarterback. But I think the Dolphins, I think they're going to regret not playing Tannehill, thinking that they could save him. He'd be healthy for the playoffs if they get there. And the Dolphins play Matt Moore. They don't make the playoffs. And the Jets will win the start that trend.
I made these picks before even Sunday happened. So I have the Dolphins winning the game. I think they still might win this game. I do see the Jets could win this game, of course. They did come back and win against the Niners, which isn't really saying much. It is the 49ers, a one-win team. But
in week one, they've lost 11 straight.
Yeah. Yeah. So I can see the Jets winning. I'm going to stick with the Dolphins though. I had them down. So I think they'll eke one out and boost their chances of maybe making the playoffs with a win.
All right.
Sunday night begin – or
actually, Sunday.
Yeah, Sunday. But, I mean, we have a question. We're going to answer this question now or after we're done with this game.
What is it?
It's a question we've already answered on the show before,
actually. Yeah.
It was a question of the week a while
ago. Yeah, we had a question of the week about that whenever he, speaking of Lamar Jackson, he won.
think it was the week after the Florida State
game. Yeah, I was trying to remember. It was the week after the Florida State game when they beat Florida State 63-10. He's a lot like him, I'll tell you that. Now, is he the next Michael Vick? Hopefully he doesn't kill dogs. I don't think anybody should do that. That's horrible. He's a lot like him, though. There's a good chance he could be. There's a good chance he could be. He still has another year in college, though. So let's see how he plays out all next year, and then I'll let you know after that.
Yeah, it's kind of really dependent on how he evolves his game here in the next coming
season. As you said, his passing.
His passing. Which, I mean, Michael Vick wasn't known for his passing, though.
No.
Exactly. I mean, Michael Vick did have an arm on him, though.
Oh, for sure. One
of the biggest arms in the world. But, I mean, he could be if he pans out like that. The thing with Michael Vick, when he was playing, he was kind of an enigma of his time.
He was,
the early 2000s when he came out. He was one of the first of this new generation, so to speak, of running quarterbacks.
Yeah.
I mean, he wasn't the first running quarterback ever, but he's the first of this now long line of running quarterbacks. And now it seems like every quarterback's a running quarterback for the most part, especially coming out of college. You rarely see a quarterback that does not really run the ball at all. So,
but the difference between Vic and Jackson, Vic was like this in high school at Warwick down in Newport News, Virginia. And Lamar Jackson, no one wanted him to play quarterback going into college. They wanted him to play safety. Vic, going into college, he was a quarterback, you know. But Petrino took a chance on Jackson and started him as a true freshman last year, quarterback. And it's turned out, hell, he won the Heisman last week. So that's the only difference. Vic was a quarterback going into college. Jackson wasn't to every team in the country except for Louisville. And Vic, number one recruit, chose one of the home state teams in Virginia Tech.
Yeah. All right. So now we'll get into our Sunday slated games, starting with the Titans taking on the Chiefs.
I think this could be the game of the week.
It could be. It definitely has probably some of the biggest playoff implications as well. Titans needed to stay alive in the AFC South and the wild card. Chiefs needed to basically possibly even almost cinch up the AFC West because they do play the Broncos and then the Chargers in the last week of the season. So definitely seen they can beat the Chargers easily. But this will really help them winning the AFC West and getting first round bye. I'm going to take the Chiefs. It's an Arrowhead in this game. I can definitely see the Titans doing something in this game because although what they did against the Broncos works well because it's the Broncos, and the Broncos need to run the ball. They're not a great passing team. The Chiefs are very well-rounded in everything pretty much. They're not the best team in the world. Like on the offensive end, but
but when it comes down to it, a win's a win.
Yeah, that's what they do.
So, and that's what Andy Reid's done in his whole career when he was in Philly and now in Kansas City. Now, his playoff record, he's 11-11.
Yeah.
So, say the Chiefs make the playoffs, it's a toss-up if they'll win. But, as I said, I think this could be the game of the week. I think it's going to be low scoring. I think Tennessee's going to go into Arrowhead and pull out the victory.
That would be a really huge win for them.
Yes, it would.
Forward. Next is another great game. Two teams that are 9-4 battling. One's battling to win the division. One's battling for the wild card and the division still yet.
Yeah.
Lions taking on the Giants in East Rutherford, New Jersey at MetLife Stadium. It's going to be a really good game. Like I said, the Lions could clinch this weekend with a win and a Packers loss. And then the Giants, they can win. And if the Cowboys were to lose later on the night, they'll be just one game back of the NFC
East. And then they beat them twice this year.
All they need to do is tie the Cowboys at this point. But I'm going to take the Lions are riding a 5-game win streak now, I think it is. 5 or 6.
It's five.
I think they're going to go in. I think the Giants, after a big win on Sunday night, might come out a little flat, possibly, even though they weren't exactly fantastic in the game on Sunday night. But I think the Lions are going to come in, get a big win, and actually win the NFC North possibly here this weekend.
And win the NFC North for the first time in a while. Because they made the playoffs as a wild card team a couple of seasons ago. I'm going to take the New York Giants. I think, they stumbled, as you said it last week, a little bit, but they pulled out the win. I think Eli's going to have a better game. And if New York can run the ball effectively, there's no doubt they're going to win, but if they can't, they're going to have some trouble, and then that's when I can see Detroit winning. But I'm gonna pick the Giants.
All right. One more, then we got another question. Colts taking on the Vikings, going to Minnesota to take on the Vikings. Again, two teams that could use it. Vikings, though, they don't need it as much, I don't think. It's going to be really hard for them to make the playoffs. They're going to have to hope for a wild card spot, I think, at this point, because, of course, they've lost twice to the Lions already. They're going to have a tough uphill battle to beat the Lions to take over the NFC North, to overtake them. And the Colts, they're still battling for the NFC, or the AFC South, rather. But they're a game back. They've lost to Texans, I think, both times this season. So they're on an uphill battle there as well. So it's an interesting game, but I'm going to take the Vikings. They're at home. They've been playing pretty good defensively lately. I think they're going to be able to shut down Andrew Luck in the end. And that's going to be the main difference in this game. Because, of course, the Colts aren't the best running team in the NFL at all.
No, they haven't been. But they've been thrown. They threw a couple screens to Frank Gore last week. He broke one off and scored. I think if they can do that and then they run the ball as well with him, and then Luck he doesn't have to have a great game.
Yeah.
I think they go into Minnesota and get the win. Now going back to the question, who do we think is going to get first round byes?
Yes, that's the question.
We'll start with the AFC and then go to the NFC to say that. We'll go to the NFC first because then our next game is an AFC game. All right,
that would be the same way.
The NFC, I think I think Dallas is going to get the one seed if they don't stumble. They could lose to Tampa Sunday night. I believe they play Detroit now on the day after Christmas on Monday Night Football, and then they got to play
Philadelphia.
Play Philadelphia at you the, end, tough at early the end of the year. So if they don't stumble in their last three games, I think Dallas gets the one seed. And then, possibly Detroit. If they win Sunday and Green Bay loses, right? They win the division, or if they just win,
they need the Green Bay loss because they're two up on the Green Bay now. If they're still two up after this week, of course they play them again in the final week of the season. The Packers have already won one of the games. Packers win that game, they hold the head-to-head. So
I could see Detroit. If they win and Green Bay loses as the two, but you can't forget about the Seattle Seahawks.
No.
They're going to win, more than likely win the West because all the other teams in the division are not that good this year.
They've almost already have. They just need a win and a card. Actually, all they need to do is win this week, pretty much.
No, the Cardinals still have to lose one.
So they need a win and a Cardinals loss.
Now, if Seattle would have beat Green Bay this past week and Arizona
would have clinched.
If Seattle would have won because Arizona lost, they would have won the West by now. But you can't forget about Seattle. I think they have a better shot to get the number two seed and get a bye just because Green Bay is coming in hot right now. They could ruin the Detroit Lions' hopes of getting that bye, and then Detroit would have to play in the wild card game.
Well, Seattle needs the bye.
Sure, and we talked about that a little bit ago with their games traveling the whole way across country three times already this year.
And they've had some stinkers on the road this season.
Yeah, they have.
Last week, so, against the Bucks a couple weeks ago. I mean, they need it more than any other teams. So they'll get one with a division win, of course.
So I think Dallas won, Seattle too. Green Bay's coming in so hot right now, winning their last two after losing four straight. I still think Green Bay's going to win the North because they play each other.
They easily could.
They play each other last weekend of the season.
They easily could because if you look at the Lions' schedule, they have a tough schedule because they play the Giants this week. And then, of course, we're thinking now they play the Cowboys the week after.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure they play the Cowboys Monday Night Football.
And then, of course, Green Bay last week of the season and for possibly the division, which is basically what the North has been the last couple of years. Last game of the season, whoever wins it wins the division. But first round buys, NFC, I got to say the Cowboys, of course. I mean, they could easily lose these two games that we're talking about, the Bucks and the Lions.
They could. And then
the Giants could walk
then
in.
Then the Giants could win the East then, and then who knows, they could get a first round bye.
They could. But the other one, I like the Lions, actually, to do it. Just the way the Seattle's been playing on the road, I think they're going to lose another game maybe here down the season. They might lose to Arizona even here next week. Who knows? But I'm going to go with the Lions for right now. Of course, the Packers can actually come in and possibly win the North. I mean, the Cowboys could easily lose these two games coming up these next 2 weeks, and actually the last three games, if you want to count the Packers game as well, of course, which they, I'm going to say they probably will, because the Cowboys seem to have the Lions number all the time, and they did earlier this season as well, crushed them. But those are my NFC buys, Cowboys and Lions at the moment.
All right, and then AFC, might as well pick this game right now. Patriots at the Broncos, I think we both can agree the Patriots are going to get the one seed.
I think the Patriots are going to get the one, and then I'm going to have the Chiefs at the two. Whoever wins the AFC West is going to get the two, I guess we'll say, but I think it's going to be the Chiefs, because their head-to-head over the Raiders is the big factor, and all they need to do is basically tie with the Raiders in record to do that. And the Chiefs have an all right schedule. The Titans and the Chargers with the Broncos in between them. It's not that bad of a schedule. While the Raiders play, who do they play this week? I forget. But then they play the Colts and then the Broncos last week of the season. So they have a little bit of a tough schedule down the stretch. I forget who they play. I swear, I forget who they play this weekend. It might be the Texans, even though.
No, they played the Texans.
Oh, they're in Mexico City. Oh, that's right. They're playing Mexico City. I'm thinking AFC South, maybe the Jaguars, which would be a good thing for them. But
the NFL announced as well the Mexico City game next year. Oakland's going to play New England in Mexico City.
Yeah.
And then the NFL also announced today the four London games for next year. You got the Ravens taking on the Jaguars, the Saints taking on the Dolphins, the Browns playing Arizona, if I'm not mistaken. And then, what was the last one I told you? Do you remember? No, he really didn't care when I told him. I know two of the four. I know the Browns play over there as well. So, should be fun, interesting. As I said, I'm going to take the Patriots as a one seed, and then I'm going to take the Chiefs as well. We got a little kitty cat on the show today. Take the Chiefs at two, and then they'll both get byes. And then I said earlier, the rematch I'd really like to see would be from the divisional round last year and the AFC title game this year between the Patriots and the Chiefs. Because the Chiefs could have beat the Patriots, and then they, who knows, they could have beat the Broncos, and then the Broncos don't even win the Super Bowl last year. And Peyton Manning doesn't go out a champion, but we'll leave it at that for that. So, who are you going to take in the Patriots-Broncos game, though?
Oh, I'm taking the Patriots in this one, and it's just going to help escalate the Broncos' unlikelihood of making the playoffs this season after winning the Super Bowl the previous season. So, the Patriots are really, really good. We know that. I think they're going to walk into Mile High and pick up a big victory. Well, not the biggest victory ever, but they'll pick up a good win against the Broncos.
Not as big as what it was when Tom Brady would be playing Peyton Manning.
Yeah.
Because that this is what that game would be if Peyton wanted to have retired. Now, first, I did put down the Broncos to win, but I'm going to change my mind after last night with what the Patriots did to the Ravens. They started out strong. Now they took it slow and steady there in the second half, and they almost blew the game, but I think Belichick's going to have them prepared a little bit better, especially going on the road in Denver in the higher elevation. And I think New England's going to beat Denver.
All right. Sunday night then is the Buccaneers taking on the Cowboys in Dallas. And I'm going the upset. I am taking the Tampa Bay Buccaneers to win their sixth straight game against the Cowboys, because of the way the Cowboys have played the last couple weeks. I think the Bucs are going to go off of that big defensive performance against the Saints this past week at home, go in, take on a team that has some pretty poor offensive performance the last couple weeks, I would say, in the Cowboys. Cowboys coming off a tough loss this past week. Maybe that continues this week. Maybe they come out a little bit slow after a big loss, after a big 11-game win streak. Yeah. So, and I said earlier in the show, the theme of losing streaks after having a big win streak has kind of been a thing in football in general, college as well. But I think the Buccaneers might go to Dallas and pick up a big win and make a strong case for the NFC South and almost pretty much cinch up possibly the wild card at least.
I'm going to match that. I'm also going to take the Tampa Bay Buccaneers over the Dallas Cowboys for everything he said. And I think it's going to lead to Dak and Tony Romo possibly both playing in that Monday night game then against Detroit, right after Christmas. I don't think as I said, I think it's going to come down to a game time decision on who they're going to start. But I think they'll end up now thinking about it. I think they'll play both of those guys in that game. But I'm going to take the Bucks in an upset. A lot of people would say, or the Cowboys, for the Cowboys to lose their second straight this year.
Yeah.
After that 11 game win streak, as you said.
Yeah. And then Monday Night Football is the Carolina Panthers going to Washington to play the Redskins.
Going back to that Bucks Cowboys game, I think this could potentially be the game of the year in the NFL. Of the year.
Oh, that'd be that's
game of the year.
That's a big statement to make, you know, right there.
Now Dak, leading to that, I don't think he has to have a great game, and then that leads to, Romo possibly playing. I think Zeke's going to run. I think he's going to have at least 150 yards rushing. But then Jameis Winston and the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, they're going to put up a lot of points as well. So I think there's implications for this to be possibly the game of the year.
All right.
Because really, what other game has there been this year that could be game of the year, if you ask me?
You could put the Broncos-Chiefs game from a couple weeks ago. It was a really exciting game.
All right.
I mean, I have to look at all the games from this past season. I mean, I don't have them off the top of my head or on my list right now. Yeah. But yeah, I'd have to look at that and get back to you on that if you really wanted to know. But yeah, it could be. Who knows? Then Monday night, like I said, Panthers, Redskins. I'm going to go Redskins this one. They're another team that could sneak into the playoffs. They're 7-5-1, I think it is.
Yeah. The tie was the Cincinnati and London.
Yeah, the tie could either help or hurt them. Who knows? We'll have to see what happens whenever the end of the season comes, how the record is. But I think they get a win here against a pretty struggling Carolina Panthers team. They won pretty good this week against the Chargers, the Panthers did.
Yeah.
They get to 5-8 on the season.
Their defense was pretty good last week.
But the Redskins' high-powered offense, I think, is going to be too much for the Panthers in that one, and the Redskins are going to win the game.
I'm also going to take the Redskins. A lot of people thought the Panthers, you know, they'd make the playoffs. They're a lock for the playoffs after last year, you know, to go back. And they haven't been like that at all this year. And because the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, team we've talked about, have really coming up out of the grave. Because as I said, the last time they won five straight, they won the Super Bowl. Now, I'm not saying they're going to win the Super Bowl this year, but, you know, history stands by that. You know, there's a good chance they're going to win the South and make the playoffs. So, I'm going to take the Redskins. Kirk Cousins, I think, will have a good game.
All right. So, all of our football for this week is now. We don't have a question of the week.
We forgot to do that.
We forgot to get one.
I know question of the day on Sunday will be who's going to win the Buccaneers-Cowboys game, so I don't want to use that.
Why don't you use one of the questions?
The question of the day for today is, though, who's going to win the NHL game tonight between the Chicago Blackhawks and the New York Rangers. So go to our Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram to vote on that. Question, like, what do you want to use?
We can use one of the questions that we used earlier here.
All right.
Maybe. And maybe in the stream. I don't know. Broncos playoff chances, maybe? Or
what team? Well, no, let's use Jesse Cruz's question.
All right.
What teams do you think are going to
get
first round buys in the playoffs this year?
All right.
So thank you to Jesse
for our question of the week.
That will be our question of the week for this week, because we totally forgot about that.
We forgot to go over that when we started.
That's our question of the week then this week. So thank you.
Quick recap, what are your teams? Just so everyone knows.
Question. Yeah, okay. Cowboys and Seahawks in the NFC, and Patriots, Chiefs in the AFC.
And mine are the same. I just have the Lions in the
NFC. I had the Lions there too. There's a possibility, but I think Green Bay's going to win the North.
Yeah, okay. So that's it. So that's going to wrap it up here on this edition of Across the Goal Line. Subscribe to our YouTube page. Like us on Facebook. Follow us on Instagram and Twitter at ATGL16. All the links are floating around somewhere. Either on YouTube or on Facebook right now. Who knows? They're everywhere.
Yeah.
They're on all of our social media platforms. But you can follow Luke on Twitter at CoolOnLuke96, me at CMAINS14 on Twitter as well. You can buy our merch, which you can contact us about using all the social media platforms, or emailing us at AcrossTheGoalLine2016@gmail.com. And for Luke Gossart, I'm Corey Maines, and we will see you on the next edition of Across the Goal Line, live from the field.